didn't do it in prayer from, what, 9 to 9:30. Then we started doing from 9 to 9:45, and then from 9 to 10. This morning went 9 to 10:15. But I don't cut prayer off because we need prayer.
Amen.
And I told them, and I wanted prayer this morning. God has told me, well, not he told you now, that we're not going to get out of where we're in until we learn to pray.
Amen.
We're not going to work our way out of it. We're not going to buy our way out of it. We're not going to give folk money enough to get out of it. We're going to pray our way out of it. And the reason he's letting things happen to us is that he's going to drive us to our knees so we move forward on our knees. And he's not being mean, but he's gonna make us or break us, and when we pray, he will respond to us. He's not trying to be mean, but he's convinced me that we're not gonna get out of what we're in. We're not gonna get over what we're in until we humble ourselves and pray. So I want to thank those who were in prayer this morning. I was encouraged, and I told them some morning we may just have prayer, sermon, and go home. Because God is good.
Amen.
And we need prayer.
Amen.
I can tell you this to our turn bluer in the face. But there's so many words that God is trying to encourage us to pray. Jesus said in Luke 18:1, men are always to pray, not faint. That was the message of this. I don't pray about it, I will faint because of it.
Yes.
Paul says, pray always. Be instant in prayer, continuing in prayer. James says, pray for one another, confess your faults to one another, and pray for one another for the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous man availeth much. If you want much to happen, little prayer. Little happen, much prayer, much happen. I don't ever get tired of praying. I pray constantly. You know, Muslims say that I pray what, 3 times a day, morning, night. Listen, I pray 3 times before you get out of bed. Then I pray 3 more times on my knees for even head to the bathroom. Because I can't pray enough. Because I know that God can constantly commune with me, empowers me, and strengthens me through prayer. If you think I got some strength, it came through prayer, not through my finances or my sentence, but through my prayers. Old folks say, y'all, stay prayed up. Because I want the church to know that we're not going to get through who we are in until we learn to pray. Until we enjoy prayer. Until we seek prayer. Because God said, when you seek me, you shall find. But you have to seek me with all your heart. And so, I want to encourage you to pray. Because people will be healed, people will be helped, and people will be comforted through your prayer. Because the text says, the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man makes things happen. Availeth much. You want things to happen in your family? You want things to happen in your children? You need to stop fussing at them and pray for them. The fussing got it. But prayer will make it. Prayer will make a difference. So I want to thank you for being this morning, and I want to try to do this message that God has given me, and I want to thank you for Kel, because at first I said, well, I think I just take the day off, and if God gave me a message, I said, well, Kel, I'm going to go ahead and do the message this day. But I want to encourage you, because God has been speaking to me all week about where we are, where we need to be, and where he wants to take us to. If you don't like where you are, that's good, because God wants to take you to a better place. If you don't like what's going on, that's good, because God wants to take you to a place where something better happens. And when he let things happen that we don't like, it's not to make us miserable, but to make us focus on him. So he can take us to the place he wants us to be. And I meditated on what God was saying to me this week. He reminded me that to get in touch with him, to understand how to connect with him, how to have his presence and power flow from him to you is really not that hard. We make it hard because we get distracted. We get disconnected. We get discontented. And we get discouraged. But the process of God couldn't make a process hard for us. We miss it. The process is simple, but we can't let things that seem hard disconnect us from the process of being connected to God. in our text in Psalm 46, David talks about what we have from God, and then he talks about how we can connect with God, to get from God what God has for us. And David said very simply in Psalm 46:10, be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God. That seems like a very simple command. That seems like a very clear instruction from God. That when it comes to dealing with life and life challenges and life problems and life pressures, God's instruction is to be still and know that I am God. But what makes that hard is that that instruction is contrary to all the advice we get in the world. The world says, you gotta fix this, you gotta do this, you gotta handle this, you got to make this, you got to be there, be here, and be everywhere. But God says, you're going everywhere. And you're doing everything, won't make things happen. Be still and know that I am God. You see, that's contrary to the way we think. Because we're taught from even as a child that we ought to be busy. That we need to be doing something, running behind something, running after something, trying to get something, trying to accomplish something. It's hard to be still. Because we live in a very fast-paced and hectic world. And the normal person is very busy. The normal person has a lot of things to do. The normal person has a lot of places to go. In fact, we think folks something wrong with them if they're not busy. You tell folks you weren't doing something, they wonder what's wrong with you. You tell folks you weren't wrapped up and tangled up and tied up and messed up, they think, what's wrong with you? You're not busy. I call your house and you weren't doing anything. Well, maybe you ought to stop calling my house and do something, do nothing to you. Well, you see, God's instruction to us is different than what we're taught in life. You see, we love, even though we complain about being busy, we really love being busy. In fact, when we don't have anything to do, we ourselves feel slain. We feel like, what's wrong? I don't have anything to do. I don't have any place to go. You call somebody, what you doing? I ain't doing nothing. I call you, what you doing? I ain't doing nothing either. Like, we think there's something wrong with doing nothing. We measure ourselves and brag on how busy we are. Girl, you up till from out of the tree. I was all day doing papers and doing my hair and washing and ironing and picking and pulling and throwing and tucking and piking. Girl, I was busy all night long. We love being busy. We think I'm wrong if we're not busy. But God said, be still and know. And sadly, no, do we love being busy, Brother Milton? Sometimes we love being a busybody. We think it's our job to be in everybody's business. Teresa accused me of that. But I'm trying to help you. We think it's our job to know everybody's business. Sometimes people come to bother me. I go to the hospital and they'll call me and say, well, how's someone doing? I say, well, they say, what's the problem? I don't know, I didn't ask. They get mad, you didn't ask me. They didn't tell me. I'm not the doctor. I'm not going to prescribe anything. I'm not going to run out and get a prescription. I don't need to know what's wrong. I don't need to worry about business. In fact, the Bible tells us that we should not be a busybody in other folks' affairs. So we need to be careful that we don't let our business distract us and disconnect us from the presence and the power of God. I think busyness sometimes is a trick of Satan to keep us from getting connected and being confident in the presence and the power of God. Because if we don't see something happen, we don't think nothing is happening. Ain't nothing happening, girl. I care my application, ain't nothing happening. I called him to check him out. It ain't nothing happening. Because you don't know that it didn't happen. So God's instructions for us this morning is, listen, David said in the first part, they said, God is our refuge. God is our strength, our very present help in any trouble. But we forget that if we get busy. It doesn't matter what it looks like. It doesn't matter what it feels like. God is present. And God is our help. God is present. God is present. Just because it don't look like nothing's going on. And just because you can't make anything go on. And just because you can't stop things from going on. And just because you can't change what's going on. Doesn't mean that God is not present and that God is not aware. God is present. Convince yourself, first of all, that God is present. David said, the Lord is my shepherd. I said, oh, why? Because he's with me. Yet if I walk through the valley of death, I'll feel no evil. Why? Because he's with me. Listen, just convince yourself, first of all, that he's with you. Because once you convince he's with you, then you begin to see what he's doing for you. David said, listen. Yeah, they'll walk about yourself, there's nothing no evil. Because thou art, that's what it said. Simply with me. Didn't say I had any money. Didn't say I had a good job. Didn't say I had good resources. Didn't say I had folks helping me. Didn't say I had a plan. Didn't say I had it worked out. Didn't say I had it figured out. Didn't say I knew what to do. Didn't know how to do. Didn't know where to do. He said, I just know God is with me. If you can just convince yourself that where we are and what was going on in your life, that God is with you. And he's with you. He is your strength and your refuge and your help in your present help in the time of trouble. You know, I appreciate folks who try to remind me not to be too busy. Some of the people remind me that I emailed them or texted them at 2:30 in the morning. I said, you must be busy. No, 2:30 in the morning is a good time, but I ain't busy. Then I can email y'all. Don't say nobody else. Message one. God said, well, you're not going to get what you want to get by being busy. That's the first message. Because you haven't gotten what you want by being busy. One job to get what you want, two jobs, still haven't gotten what you want. One woman that satisfies you, two, then it just makes it worse. Getting more does not make things better. You gotta change your mindset. God's message is, being busy will not get you what you need. And will not get you what you want. This is how Jesus said in Matthew 16:26, what is the profit of man to gain the whole world and to lose his own soul? What will man give in exchange for it? So Jesus said, you can gain the whole world. You haven't got anything. So being busy will not get you what God wants you to have. You don't get that busy. You're not going to get it because you're so strong or so wise. Did not God say, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. Listen, I know what God is teaching is different than what you're taught. That we're talking about this. On our job, the supervisor come around, we start playing like we business on. Because we think they'll keep an employee that's busy. You know, I tell folks the reason we're good at solving problems. Because we like to focus on solving problems. We don't like to focus on preventing problems. You don't go to work and say, I prevent a problem. You go to work and say, well, I solve a problem. I tried to teach you more than your method. I said, let's prevent problems. You can't give them credit for that. They don't give no war for preventing problems. They give war for solving problems. Because on your job, the more problems you solve, what? The better employee. The more things I'm doing, the better things I'm doing. Because being busy will not get you what you want, and he won't get what he wants you to have. He won't get it by being busy. fact, did he not say that it waited upon the Lord shall renew their strength? They shall mount wings of eagles, they shall run, not get weary, they shall walk and not faint. We've got to work on our mind, but our mind right now are focused on being busy. Because that's what the world values. And so sometimes we get caught in the world system and the world value, and we spend a lot of time being busy trying to solve problems rather than knowing God and being still and allowing God to fix problems. God says, you won't get what you want by being busy. Because God's already promised. If you need something good, who has it? I just want something good. God's got it. So I don't have to be busy to get what God wants me to have. I don't have to be busy to achieve what God wants me to do. Didn't I change it? Every good gift is from above and coming down from the Father of light, and who has no variable, neither shadow turning. Say, God's got it. You don't have to be busy to get read out. You just have to be connected. And our business often disconnect us rather than connect us. So to give up, you may have to be busy to get what your company wants you to have. But don't get your company mixed up with God. You don't have to be busy to get what God wants you to have. In fact, I think business shows like a confidence in God because we're trying to do stuff for ourselves that God has not done for us. And we're trying to do it through our might, through our power. He said, you won't get it that way. You won't get it by power. You won't get it by might. But by my spirit will lead you. My spirit will teach you. My spirit will direct you. My spirit will guide you. My spirit will empower you. My spirit will lead you to get, to see, and to hear, and to feel what I want you to have. This is what God said. I know he said. Because first, Samuel 20, he said, eyes have not seen. Is that right? You won't see it by looking for it. Ears have not heard. You won't get it by listening for it. Your heart has not been able to feel. Your feelings won't lead you to it. He said, neither have ears nor heart, but God has prepared for them that way. But he revealed it to him by his spirit. You see that? You can look all you want. You're not going to see what God wants you to see until the Spirit of God reveals it to you. You can try all you want. You're not going to get what God wants you to get until the power of God empowers you. You can step as late as you want. I told you that a couple seconds ago, Psalm 127. You can step as late as you want. He said, it's a waste of your time to sit there, rise up early, to sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrows. God said, go to be still and go to sleep. For so he gives his beloved. I told you I prayed that prayer. 19:7-1. And I haven't had a sleepless night since. In fact, my problem now is God really answered, but I can't stay up. I fall asleep in the couch. Oh, you meant it to be. My wife is on the couch. She don't like me in the couch. She finally put a sheet on the couch. You can't make the bed no way. She put a sheet on the pillow. You ain't making the bed no way. You can't even get here. Just sit up there. She's gonna wake me up. She might say, "I can come. I'm going to get your pillow to the black man because you ain't that's what you mean." Amen. I'm glad that God locked me in the cradle of the Lord. He sings lullabies to me, and he makes my eyes drowsy, and he closes them, and I sleep. Because I know he's present. I know he's present. I don't know a lot of things, but I know God. He's present. I'm depending on the presence of God to bring with it the power. And I decide I really don't care how God uses power because he's going to use it for good. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and coming down from the Father of light. And whom there is no variable, just be the shadow of turning. Be still, he says. And know. We all know to be so busy. You remember God told Israel when they were coming out of Egypt? They got afraid when they saw Pharaoh's chariots. They saw Pharaoh's army, the Red Sea was ahead of them, the marsh was on the side of them, the wilderness was on one side, the marsh was on the side, and they began to tell Moses, you brought us out here, and now we're in trouble, and you know, I came to church, I joined church, I started praying, I started singing, I started living for God, and now I'm having trouble, and God told them to be still.
Yeah.
Be still. He said, first of all, he said, fear not. Stop being afraid. Paul said in 1 Timothy, he's not given us the spirit of fear, but love and sound mind. But power and love and sound mind. So see, he told you, stop being afraid. That's the first thing. Then the second thing, he said, stand still. Stop running around! We just hear something go wrong. What am I going to do? Who am I going to call? Who am I going to talk to? How am I going to get it? How am I going to get it? Be still. Stand still. Stop! Stop it! Stop it! Stop it! Take faith in this. I get to believe God. I get to trust God. Stop. Don't be trying to cross the Red Sea. Don't be trying to go back. Don't be trying to go out to the wilderness. Don't be trying to go out to the marsh. Stop. Think about how you're going to get yourself out of this thing. Stand still. That's hard, isn't it? Because we're taught to move. Listen, I still have a problem standing still. When I traffic jam, the first thing I start looking is another route. And I'll go 20 miles out of the way, keep me stopped 10 minutes. Because I'm moving. I'm moving. I tell you, I'm not going to lie. And every now and then, when I'm not traveling, God just stopped the traffic. Be still. My wife and I was coming back to Florida, and we made it, Milton. I mean, I was humping and getting, y'all pass? Montgomery, y'all pass? Birmingham. Get 30 miles from Huntsville, and boom! Stop. Let me see, what can I cut down through 69, 78, and got to be still. We don't have to start figuring so many things out. Be still. And if we're too busy to do something for God, then we're just too. A Christian ought not to be too busy to do something for God. Because God is trying to do something for you. How can I have a God that protects me? A God that provides for me? A God that defends me? A God that defended your son, a God that protected your son, a God that preserved your son, and I'm running around worried about doing something. If I get too busy for God, it's because I don't trust God to be busy for me. How can I get too busy for God if God's already said he's going to protect me, provide me, keep me, deliver me, sustain me, but I'm too busy? That's really too busy. And sometimes we think it's okay because we say, well, God knows my needs. Yes, he does know your needs. He said, I know the need you before you ask. And I'm still telling you, don't be so busy that you block me out, that you leave me out. You know what David said? I won't get too busy with God. Because God's been too good to me. You know what David said? He said, he's done tremendous things. He has forgiven all my iniquities. He has healed all my diseases. He redeemed my life from destruction. He has crowned me with loving kindness. He has given me tender mercy. He has satisfied my mouth with good things. How can I get too busy for God? I'm not too busy. The song, Never to Disease. Oh, y'all know the song. I'm singing like a Christian. Y'all know the song. They know the song.
I'm a Christian. I don't listen to that station.
Too often we make our Christian about what we don't do, but nobody ever see our Christian about what we do. I get a suspicion of Christians when all they tell me what they don't do. Well, what do you do, baby? Do you study the word? Do you worship? Do you pray? Do you praise? But you just don't do nothing, huh? That was David's attitude. David, listen, because all the good things that God has done, in the call of worship, that's why he's going to go to Psalm 66. I will pay my vows unto the Lord now in the presence of all his people. David, I'm going to do things. I'm going to promise God things. I'm going to do things for God because of all the things he's done for me. And David, I'm not going to do it when I'm in a good position. I'm not going to do it when everything is working for me. David, I'm going to do it right. I'm going to pay my vows now. Not next week, not next Sunday, not next time I come to church, not when I get everything in order, not when I get a good job, not when I get an education, not when I fix this, finish that, done that. Listen, if you're going to do all that, you don't need God. What God going to do? God, I can't help you, but you do another thing. You know, he has a jealous God. He wants to do something. He won't say, I am the one who redeemed you. I am the one who crowned you with loving kindness and tender mercy. I am the one who healed you. You got all that. You didn't leave anything for me. You're your own God. David said, I'm going to do something for God because God has done something for me. He said, I will pay my vow. Now, he said, not when I get things together. Not when everything is all right. Not when I've finished doing what I've been doing. Not when I feel better. But now. And he said, I'm going to do it in the presence of all his people. Folk will know I'm doing things for God. He said, well, all the folks see me doing it. Jesus said, let your light so shine so men may see your good works. See, not just good works to be doing good works, but good works to glorify your Father. People need to know you're doing stuff for God. People need to know that you're being kind to God. People need to know that you're giving because you love the Lord, not because you're just a good person. I'm just a good person. No, I'm good because I'm not a good person. I can be a selfish person. I can be a self-centered person. I can be a self-focused person. But because I love God, I take my mind off me and give stuff that I'm do stuff I plan to do, right? I'm not fooling Michael Hartwell. Michael Hartwell is not a good person. He's a bad, low, hard-headed, sneaky, tricky fella. That's who he is. In his natural self. And he needs the power of God to be able to do the things that God wants him to do. Because if I did what Michael Hartwell wanted me to do, there are a lot of nights I would have gone. There are a lot of things that wasn't going to work if I done what Michael Hartwell wanted. What Michael Hartwell whispered in Michael Hartwell's ears to do. What Michael Hartwell put in Michael Hartwell's heart to do. Well, I haven't learned not to listen to Michael Hartwell. Michael Hartwell is fine. Like Paul said, I know in me. Well, that is in my flesh. Well, no. Michael Hartwell had to work real hard not to listen to Michael Hartwell. David said, because he had redeemed my life from destruction, because he has forgiven all my iniquities, because he killed all my diseases, because he has crowned me with loving kindness and tender mercies, because he has satisfied my mouth with good things. I went to the doctor today, he said, you are satisfying your mouth with too many good things, you picked up some pounds. I know what the problem is, I'm taking chips every night, I get about 6 bags, 2 sodas, Cheez-Its. Every time I say, I want you to eat 1 bag, 6 bags later, wait, I just get 2 Cheez-Its. I'm just going to bring 1 soda. But he satisfied my mouth with good things. And if you're on the floor, my wife will give up. She gave me a room, she just gave up. She said, this is your room. You got cornflakes all the floor, you got potato chips all the floor, you got cheese on the floor. This is your room, stay in there and don't come out. He satisfied my mouth with good things. He don't leave no bitter taste in my mouth. I I'm gonna get home tonight and get the potato chips. I stopped by, got me 12 bags over here. 2 6 packs of sodas, Dr. Pepper, Mr. Misty, whatever it is. I just drank it. It's wet and cold. I can't wait to get home and satisfy my mouth with some God didn't cook. That's why I love it, because he satisfied my mouth with good thing. That old leg was hurting me. He healed all my diseases. But I love him because he forgives all my iniquities. That's what David said. I will pay my vows unto the Lord. Now, in the presence of his saints. See, don't let things keep you so busy that keep you from being still. David said in our text, be still and know that I am God. And I know that's something we've got to work on, because that's different than what we're talking. It's different than what the world does. It's different than the advice the world gives. But we've got to listen to God more than we listen to the world. And even more than we listen to ourselves. Be still and know. Even in the church thing, and especially in church things, that goes God. That is God who's directing us. It is God who. There are a lot of things we may want to do, but we need to make sure that it's the thing that God wants us to do. Be still and know. I want to show you Wednesday night in Bible class how I can know when the Spirit is speaking to me, how I can know when the Spirit is leading me. Because the Spirit makes itself evident. The Bible says the Spirit is manifest, evident, it shows. Because what we're going to learn in Bible class next several weeks is that the church operates by the power of the Spirit. And so we've got to know when the Spirit's operating, how the Spirit operates, so the church can operate by the Spirit. We're going to talk about seeing the power of God in action. And he only acts through his Spirit. There's a difference between when the church is acting in this Spirit and when the church is acting in the Spirit of God. And sometimes we act in our Spirit, and our Spirit overrules the Spirit of God. David said in closing in Psalm 46, we'll look at very briefly here, that we're going to have problems. They described in the first 9 verses all the problems, the kinds of problems can be counted by. He says, waters there roar. We've seen floods. He says, mountains shake. We've seen earthquakes. All these things that David was describing are things that we can encounter, things that can happen. But he still said in verse 1-2, God is our refuge, our strength, our very presence to help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Though the earth does move, and though the mountains are carried into the midst of the sea, we will not fear. Because he said, the Lord of hosts is with us. Be still and know, he says, I am God. When God let things happen, he lets them happen at opportunity in the Lord. When folks see God bring us out of things, and when folks see God bring us through things, and when folks see us faithful to God in spite of things, that brings glory to God. He said in text, he said, I will be exalted through these things. These things reveal God to people. When they see you faithful, when they see you committed, when they see you serving, when they see you working, when they see you giving, when they see you caring, when they see you sharing, in spite of things, that tells them about the power of God and it brings glory to God. We mentioned a little bit in the women's class this morning. The church as an organization has done a horrible job of bringing glory to God. People see church and not God. People see church and not Christ because they don't see church folk acting like Christ. When they see us fussing and arguing and bickering, when they see us unkind and uncompassionate and unforgiving, they don't see Christ. I'm not talking about San Diego, I'm talking about churches, universally around the world. And before he comes, Christ is going to give up on the church. He's going to come back, he says. He said, iniquity shall bow, because the love of many shall grow cold. And when he's coming back, he's looking to destroy the church that he built. Because the church has departed so far as an organization from God. Don't put your hope in church membership. Make sure that you're connected to Christ. He's coming back for those that are in Christ, not for those who are just in church. David said, we're going to experience problems. And I've talked a lot since I've been here, particularly this year, about problems, about dealing with problems. And the reason I have it, because God says we have to learn to handle problems better. We've got stuff getting upset by problems. And the third, we call their problems. And then seeing each other as the problem. And having problems with each other. Because we can't bring glory to God if we can't have a problem occurring in our lives. If we act like the world when they have problems, they won't see the Christ that's in us. And they won't know Christ is our problem solver. These problems we're having are not to break us, they're to mold us and to make us into the image of God. And to teach us that we have a problem solver. And that we among ourselves are not the problem. And we have to stop seeing each other as problems and calling each other the problem. God wants us to handle problems. He may not take us out of problems. He didn't take Israel out of the Red Sea. He took them through the Red Sea. He didn't take them out of the wilderness. He took them through the wilderness. He'll bring us through our wilderness. He'll bring us through our Red Sea if you know that God is present and that he is our refuge. When we have God's presence, David said, we have God's power. David said, God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. Old folks say what? He's always on time. I've never seen God late in my life. He may not come when I wanted him to. He may not come like I want him to, but he's always been. I never miss getting where I needed to get. I never miss being where God wanted me and needed me to be. He helps us. Right here. Don't tell somebody you've been this a long time. It ain't been long. It's been but a moment. He helps us. See, we like to dramatize our problems.
Girl, I've been put up with this so long. This is so bad. This is so hard.
God said, our light afflictions is but for a moment. See, he had a whole different perspective. He said, our light, they ain't heavy. Yeah. It's but for, yeah, you won't. Because one day, 1,000 years for him, and 1,000 years is one day, so you know. It ain't even much. When we view things as hard, it's because we don't view God as present. When we think it's wrong, it's because we're not drawn on God's power. God is our present help. Not an after a while help. Be still. Every now and then, we just need to be still. Stop trying to figure things out. Work things out. Plan things out. Just be still. When Jesus had to face the Calvary, he went to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. He wanted some time just to be still. And even to be alone. Most of us are afraid to be alone with our problems. We got to tell somebody. We got to call somebody. We got to get a group hug. Jesus showed us that sometimes people were fellas. He told his disciples, you went to sleep and I didn't pray that morning. But he prayed. Every night he would leave the disciples and go out to the wilderness alone and be with his Father. And come back to them in the morning. Even Christ had to have some alone time to draw the strength of God. Be reminded of the presence of God. And to draw the power of God. But if you've not made a decision to come to Christ, you don't have the promise of God's refuge, God's presence, and God's power. Our power from God comes through Jesus Christ, our Lord. He said, all power on heaven and earth is given unto me. The first decision you need to make today is to accept Christ as your Lord, as your Savior. Don't let your feels worry you. Don't let your problems pressure you. And don't let your feelings discourage you, bring down. Just be still and know that God wants you. Just be still and know that God wants you to come to Him. Jesus said, all that the Father giveth unto me will come unto me. And him that cometh unto me, I will in no wise cast out. He promised you he won't cast you out. He promised you he'll never leave you nor forsake you. But if you don't have the assurance of God's presence in your life, then you don't have the assurance of God's power. Because with his presence, come power. Jesus said in Acts 1:8, you shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost will come upon you. And you shall be witnesses. You'll show folk how to be still. You'll show folk that you're confident in God, that you know that God is your Redeemer. Your very presence helps in the time of trouble. What's the blessing of being a Christian if I don't have the blessings and the confidence of being a Christian? We need to let Christ be evident. And one of the best ways to show the reality of Christ is how we deal with the problems of life. That should separate us from the world. Where they have fear, we have confidence. Where they have doubt, we have assurance. And where they are discouraged, we are encouraged. And where they've given up, we are. Because Christ is in us. And yea, though we walk through the valley of shadow of death, we'll feel evil. But thou, if you're here today, and you don't make a decision to come to Christ, know that he has died on Calvary's cross to give you power. He's died on Calvary's cross and has broken the power of sin. He came, bled, and died. He became one of us. Endured the suffering of us. To break the power of the sin.